Welcome to our session on Is Truly Adaptive Learning Here at Last? And we're going to dive right into this topic. You can find our bios and things on the website or on the app as you choose, and we'll just kind of dig into this thing. The first thing I'm going to say about this, and I'm Bror Saxberg, by the way, is, it's a little bit of an insult to folks like Aristotle and Plato to suggest that, somehow adaptive learning has not ever been here. I mean, there have been honestly terrific teachers ever since speech existed who actually took great care to match learning and outcomes and methods exactly to their students. So we actually, as a panel, thought, we have to reframe this question because, it's never gone away. It's always been there. Maybe the right question for us to dig into is something more like, is systematic, scalable, affordable, truly adaptive learning here at last? Because that arguably has been the issue, which is there's always been some great adaptive learning, but it maybe hasn't been everywhere. And one of the key topics that will come up here today is, and what about technology and AI and things? I'm going to pass it to Dan to maybe take a run at this and get us started maybe on how to think about AI, but then also that broader question. Dan.
Yeah, thanks, Bror. So Dan Wittich, Riiid. The best teachers in the world do adaptive learning better than any machine does adaptive learning. And working for a technology company, that's probably a controversial statement to make. But unfortunately, those great teachers are few and far between. And so really, this concept of human and machine combined can now be a force multiplier for those great teachers. They can impact the lives of more people and more students and foster great learning with the help of machines and technology, and in particular for this panel, artificial intelligence, which I suspect we'll be talking a good deal about today.
Great, and maybe, I don't know, one of you folks maybe take a run at, so what is AI and why is it kind of incomplete in some ways as a thought? Does anybody want to take a run at that?
Sure. Well, there are many different definitions of AI that have evolved over time too. But one good way, almost an intuitive way to think about AI is it's what, when a computer has to do something that, when done by people, would require intelligence. And it's sort of an intuitive way of thinking about AI. And when we think about AI today, say in the form of applications of AI that we see from, for example, recommendations of movies on Netflix, automated speech recognition or virtual personal assistants, self-driving cars and what have you, these are all in the vein of what's called machine learning, right? So being able to actually have algorithms that are data-driven rather than some overarching definition or theory around the theory of mind or intelligence in the first place. But they also tend to be narrowly defined, right? So an AI, which is good at doing like your Amazon Alexa at making recommendations, it's not gonna be able to help you drive a car, for example, right? And same is the case in education. We see a lot of narrow applications of AI from, say, automated scoring of open responses from students, recommendation of learning resources and so forth, but they don't necessarily generalize and transfer from one location to one domain to another. And that's why we are able to very easily differentiate it from the human element, right? A good teacher is able to actually perform in a variety of different scenarios. That still remains a challenge in AI.
So, go ahead.
So, I also think that it's tempting sometimes to think that, something recently has happened that will make all of our challenges go away. It is actually 12, 13, 14 years ago, one of the really big breakthroughs we made with McGraw-Hill happened, and in the broad definition of AI, as Saad is using, it is totally AI. We have not referred to that as AI for a long time for various reasons, but in that definition it is. But it's not based on the recent breakthroughs. It's based on getting computers to behave in a more human way when you are engaging with computers on your own, which has laid the groundwork for all of McGraw-Hill's Learn Smart and Smart Book technologies, thousands of products, and used by probably today 40, 50 million higher ed students. So, but these breakthroughs are not new. What I do think is interesting with this question is this something that will have a more pervasive or more widespread effect on the way we organize the rest of education? Because what they did was they transformed the existing system to a better version of the existing system. But adaptive learning may actually now, based on the last 18 months, be the catalyst that have the chance to transform the rest of the system, change the way we're doing things, because we didn't reorganize much. We got higher grades, we have fewer dropouts, and all the things you've heard from the marketing drums from the big guys who've used this, including McGraw, but it didn't fundamentally change what higher ed was, or for that matter, what K-12 was. And I do think that that's maybe the real answer to this is, I don't think the technology has had that big of a breakthrough. I think the new AI will impact in places we don't expect it to do, but I do think that the readiness from the world to change based on the availability of this has changed.
Matt, do you have a perspective? Because you're deeply involved in that, you know, work at scale from Wiley. So
I guess I had something of a question whether a breakthrough is what we're really looking for, meaning that going back to Plato, Socrates, there is an iterative improvement that we've been seeing as we iteratively improve on these tools, and now we have the technology to help us. The technology is getting a lot cheaper. Actually, our adaptive learning products are some of our least expensive because they're meant to help people who need the most help, who tend to be in lower socioeconomic status, less selective schools. And so we try to go hand in hand to solve more of the problem, right? Because learning doesn't, you know, it's not something that's going to be between a learner and the computer. It's between the learner, the computer, their class, their life. And so what we try to do is we try to look at the whole context. And especially when you're providing tools to be used in a blended environment, you need to take advantage, need to take into consideration the entire context. And so, for example, in a typical adaptive scenario, you're trying to understand where the knowledge gaps are. But the knowledge gaps today are different than they were yesterday, right? Because they went to class in between, they talked to some friends, they did a study group, they had a TA, and so you have to reevaluate where they are and then identify the knowledge gaps. And understanding how to do that assessment rapidly in real time, and well, I guess that's a redundancy, but being able to do that in real time and then understand what the gaps are, meaning you can understand what they know, but then what do they need to know to do the particular exercise they're working on. So we're working on very complex challenges, and these kinds of challenges we work on, you know, day after day, year after year, and with both expert system, with both experts and with expert systems. So machine learning has its role, but also the experts have their role because those are who you're working with.
Actually, I would just like to underscore that point. That's so true, particularly in the application of AI in education, where transparency is key, right? So the ability to really come up with hybrid solutions over here, which are not necessarily just purely data-driven, but also take advantage or leverage what we know from, you know, since Plato, the science of learning itself, and I'm sure, Bror, you have, you know, quite a few things to say about learning engineering.
So with the risk for those who saw the panel I was on earlier, it sounded like a broken record, I do think that the biggest impact we'll see of these technologies, the moderator asked 20 years from now, I think the biggest impact we'll see is how these technologies and how AI will impact our ability for the human curation and the human aspect of this to deliver more value at a cheaper rate, at a higher quality, and at scale that can reach more people. So the same way as an engineer and an architect today is way more efficient, or as somebody who builds a space shuttle today can work way more efficiently putting human brains to work to solve really valuable and really hard problems, rather than having like this sci-fi idea about AI taking over the world and suddenly solving all of our problems for us and out comes a product. Like, it hasn't happened in engineering, and engineering is easier than education. But I do think it would profoundly transform the way we build content, the way we build what was formerly known as content, but anything we interact with. But I think humans are critically important for it. So I actually think it's the enablement we will see the biggest impact and the biggest transformation.
I'll just add a bit to that. I think acceptance matters too. So you brought up the, you know, dystopian sci-fi, you know. 20 years ago, AI was Skynet and it was terrifying. And now, you know, we have digital natives and soon we'll have AI natives. And with transparency, as Saad mentioned, and this acceptance in younger learners, I think that's going to really help this scale much more quickly than it has in the past. People are, you know, they see it on Netflix every day and it you know, they're no worse for it, and so they're more accepting of this concept of supervised and unsupervised machines helping guide the learning process.
If we go back for a minute to, you know, the Aristotle, Plato, the one-to-one highly effective tutor, and think about, so how, and there's so much evidence showing that that really makes a difference. It's not like we're making it up here. That's actually real. Part of when you watch really good one-to-one tutors, you see how many lines of information they're processing at once. And I don't mean lines as in lines of code. I mean actually processing, what is the person doing? How do they look like they're feeling at this moment? Are they paying attention? Are they like what they were yesterday and so forth? So there is this rich tapestry of non-academic information that you could argue is actually being processed in parallel and probably mostly non-consciously in the course of helping the student. So then when you think about, okay, so how do we get adaptive learning at scale in a reliable, affordable way? What, you know, how does that enter the picture? Because that's not, you know, what are you typing? That is a much richer array. Is there some other way in which that comes to pass? Or is that really where we just need to make it simpler for people to focus on that aspect of it? So I'd love any of your views on how to think about that set of dimensions as part of the tutoring side, adaptive side.
Go ahead.
I'll start. I think that's a little beyond the current scope, meaning that I don't think that you're going to have our applications picking up sentiment effectively. But again, there are so many gains that can happen before we get there that are tractable problems to solve, such as the knowledge graph, such as knowing what they actually know, but kind of assessing in the flow of their studies. And we can keep working on those and making those better. And over time, we will be able to identify sentiment. It depends when you bring the social side into our applications. And most of our applications, I actually don't know your guys as well, but don't include the social side. The social side is meant to occur outside of the application. And when the social side comes inside the application, perhaps at some point in the future, some elements of it do, you have kind of more purchase on the opportunity and introduce kind of new technology there.
So we have, like Wiley has, when we did all the work with McGraw-Hill, done a lot of work in the knowledge base, and you're right, in that space, and we did a lot of cognitive task analysis on what actually happens in that one-on-one situation with a good teacher and a student, and what was the effective ingredient. And I think there is a social-emotional part of it that is important, but there was one thing that was way more important, which was that a great teacher constantly does closed-loop, a well-known concept from engineering, that they could figure out, does this instructional situation, does this learning situation work by asking questions at a relatively high frequency and at an enormously higher frequency than we normally do. So that's the biggest effective ingredient, if you ask me, in the one-on-one situation. But I do think it's an orthogonal thing to think about the social learning and the collaborative learning and these other things. We worked on that for the last years and trying to figure out how do we actually also mass produce that? How do we build that into it? But it's two very different problems. I think the knowledge part, the biggest thing is to make sure that step by step and on that path to comprehension, not to memorizing a lot of things, because that's a different thing to memorize independent or meaningless syllables, but what is really important is how do you secure on the way that the learning actually works. But I think it's two different things.
Yeah, I would actually violently agree with you guys over here, because I would even say there's a distinction, say the plain vanilla adaptive learning, and perhaps what you're talking about is almost like precision learning, if you will, you know, where a tutor, when they bring in the full senses, right, they're able to track if the student is getting disengaged, they're getting bored, or they're finding some content to be too difficult, not because there is necessarily only one way to demonstrate that behavior, but it's because that tutor has learned over time the idiosyncrasies of that individual person. That's very hard to do at scale. I think, ultimately, that is the holy grail. We'll eventually get there, some parts of it, but there's a lot of gain to be had by just solving the plain vanilla adaptive learning. If you put a good educator in a situation where it's the first time they're meeting a student. They still can get a lot of stuff done, like answering the right questions at the right time to be able to really diagnose skill gaps. They know the subject matter well enough, so now how to make a recommendation that would be highly targeted for remediation purposes. And so if you can actually solve that problem with adaptive learning at scale, we have made a lot of headway already.
Brief comment, there are actually some things that are of the soft kind in the knowledge acquisition we found, which was when a student hesitates with an answer, that short hesitation, a good teacher picks up immediately. The look on their face, which is they're unsure about it, it's a really important signal that good teachers pick up on and that they actually use to guide what they do moving forward, which led to the interpretation of Anders Ericsson's work on deliberate practice, where you've probably seen people with colored buttons at the bottom saying, I'm sure about the answer, I have no idea, or somewhere in between. That is a direct result of that cognitive task analysis we did on great teachers there, combined with Anders's work on how do experts actually think, how this is the number one driver for being more efficient that we found also on knowledge acquisition.
Mm-hmm. What did you have something? Or?
No.
One of the other interesting puzzles that's related to this is, and it's true both for human teachers working with students and also with machine learning, which is the problem in a sense of training sets, right? That both groups have the same issue of who did you train with? Where did your insights come from, even as a teacher, compared to who are you actually teaching? And there's an interesting sort of parallel puzzle about trying to make sure that both your tools and your teachers are able to move beyond their original training sets. I don't know if you guys want to comment on that, but that's one of those, it's not just, we see it in the machine learning space, people talk about that, there are famous examples of how it goes wrong, but it's actually an interesting human problem as well, and something that has got to get resolved if you're going to end up with this affordable, scalable, effective, adaptive learning that works for all kids, not just the subset that I happen to know myself. So I don't know if any of you guys want to comment on this.
Unfortunately, that is not a challenge which is peculiar to education. That's a general AI challenge. I think in a way you're talking about artificial general intelligence. That's what sometimes people think when they think about AI, right? The Skynet solutions or what have you over here. But for the most part, the state of the art in AI is narrow AI, or narrowly defined machine learning, what have you. Now, there are some early steps being made in AGI. General purpose language models are a good example of that. Transfer learning and so on and so forth. But there are ways to go before I think we can replicate human ability of cross-domain intelligence demonstration in tasks that are unforeseen, novel scenarios. So lessons learned in one scenario, if they can be applied to another, where you don't even actually have a problem definition. So that is the big challenge, right? Identifying there's a problem to be solved and then coming up with, on the fly, a solution for it.
There may be a sub-problem that is easier to solve, which is things around context, right? Are you able to draw on, for a complex thing you're trying to help a student master, can you draw on what is already highly familiar to the student so that you're not overloading students' working memory? That feels like a thing that both teachers and technology systems might be able to be good at. If you knew enough about your students and their backgrounds and their interests, you may be able to help teachers offer up ideas, metaphors, examples that are much more familiar and much less difficult for students to actually tackle. So there may be some narrower subsets of this that actually allow you to do that. I don't know if any of you guys want to comment on that. But
I'll go ahead. I would just say that the great potential of adaptive learning is to extend from the served to the unserved markets. Hmm. And I mean, that's been the great promise to date. Maybe haven't done that great a job of getting to the underserved or unserved markets, but that the problem exists is very poignant in these cases because almost by definition, the data sets are trained on the served market, not on the underserved or unserved market. But because most of us, I would guess, start with expert-defined algorithms and then repair those over time, adjust those over time on the basis of data, that allows us to go into markets with new sets of experts that know, specific markets. A commuter school versus a four-year state institution, a school in Malaysia versus a school in the US. And we can start our systems and start generating them. And as we develop the capabilities to improve these systems over time, we can do this in different contexts.
Yeah, I think you hit the nail on the head. At my company, we rolled a product out to a Korean market that was based on American student data, and the model broke, frankly, and we had to repair it. And these are two, highly developed nations trying to, take that from this, a U.S. market and employing it in underserved countries, third world countries. It's never going to be perfect at first, but the data must be generated to fix it. We can't, that is what AI is in its essence. It's fed by data to create these new, to recognize these new patterns and create these new algorithms.
Ulrik. So we actually chose a completely different path. So the species of models and AI that we've worked on the last 15, 18 years was for that specific reason not of that kind. Because you will run into that issue if you train them that way. So the majority of McGraw-Hill's products, which is probably the biggest implementation so far in the world, they actually went to less than the top tier markets. And the other thing is that you don't use the early data to drive how you teach people later. What you do instead is, I think there are two issues in this, which is if you try to come up with the best way to teach things and you try to learn that from a population of some kind, you will run into that bias. But the other part is also it's much more a matter of what is it if it's diversity of content that is needed? What if you need 17 different ways to explain something before you run out of ways to try? Think about that grandmother who's the infinitely patient teacher of her granddaughter, always thinks the best and will constantly figure out a new way to try to see if you can get to the goal or leave it alone for a while but come back to it. If you then use analytics and things that are not AI, but to figure out this is where we need to invest more in having several different ways to do this based on what we see in a larger and larger population. And that's why it is necessary to test it on the populations that you want to do it, because you often find that certain groups have different needs, because this is just not language you talk about over dinner at home, and which is the similar problem we have with the standardized tests, right? So you definitely do need to align it to the groups, but you can circumvent some of the problems, and I think you will run straight into them you can circumvent them by not using classic AI, and you will get right into them if you do use classic AI.
I think there is a potential for another way over here, which is that, one of the bottlenecks in, I want to say, even the last, maybe in the last 15, 20 years of the advances with machine learning has been the dependence on a lot of data, which is hard to come by, clean data, right? It has to be pre-processed and what have you and so on and so forth. And while you can put in the effort to then collect the data and build bespoke models for that, you have to repeat the whole thing again for a different domain. I think what we see now in the state of the AI is to be able to build general purpose models that rely on training on large corpuses of data, but then you can fine tune them on one context. So Dan, your example, right? You might be able to actually train your models on the data that you've captured in the American market or the European market, what have you, to be able to get to some underlying common principles. But then you can contextualize and fine-tune it into your specific domains. And so, we're seeing a lot of potential with that kind of approach going forward.
I see what you did there with the fine-tune comment, by the way.
Nice. One point that came up very early, I think Ulrik, you may have mentioned it, or maybe Dan, it was you, was this notion of, we've got to have this be hybrid. It has to involve the teachers. Well, and what we know is you can't just drop the manual of, technology on the desk of a teacher and walk away. So what is it that we need to do to help teachers become able to make use of these technologies in the right way so that this adaptive capacity between the teachers and the tools really becomes accessible to everyone, as opposed to the teachers kind of trying not to use it or using it in a way that was never intended? Do you guys have any thoughts about how do we get the teachers into the middle of this? And is it a design problem where they needed to be in the design from the beginning? Or how do you guys think about that?
I'll kick us off. I think teachers want to use things that make them better able to teach or make it easier to accomplish their goals. And so that needs to be at the forefront. Don't solve problems that teachers don't think exist, even if they do exist, because the teachers won't be super jazzed up to use those tools. Whereas if you can identify pain points that they feel every day, such as assignment creation, constantly grading. My wife's a high school teacher. I've graded my fair share of papers just to get the load off of her plate. Tools like that will, you know, it's sort of the entry point for teachers. If they can use that, if they can leverage AI-powered systems to help solve the problems they feel, they'll be more likely to embrace, you know, the problems they don't know exist based on those same systems.
I think there is a range of opportunities, but I think they're very, very different. I think they're, for some teachers, it's just a matter of how do I get over that enormous burden of grading papers. And for other teachers and schools that have the aspirations to try to flip a classroom, it might actually be the thing that enables them to do that without having expert teachers, that you can lower the barrier for being able or being a catalyst for flipping classrooms. So I think there are an array of different and quite different solutions that needs to be deployed in order to get the teachers involved. I do think that one of the challenges, particularly in K-12, not as much in higher ed, but in K-12, is that the teachers are so overwhelmed that you really have to slow down. Like, we've realized that over the last many years, over and over again, that the limiting factor is actually how much bandwidth do teachers have to change the way they do things, not because they don't want to change, but because there is simply just a human limit to how much you can change over a given period of time. And therefore, you need to make sure that we do this at a calmer pace, and most importantly, that we don't run out with these insane claims that this is going to take over this, that, and the other that they do today, that we probably don't really have evidence that they can do. Whereas I think we as an industry, and we're trying to see if we can back it up in action, is to be more humble about the fact that this is helping teachers to do something, or this is helping students to learn, rather than this is something that will come in and take over the world.
Yeah, I think that it's really important for all of us to focus on the instructor as a primary consumer of the technology, not as a ancillary or someone on the sidelines. And maybe the secondary purpose of our technology is to reduce the workload of the instructor. And we reduce the workload of the instructor because the technology is pretty closely aligned with what they're trying to do as well. Whereas we're working with an individual student through the technology to understand what the knowledge gaps are, the instructor is also trying to understand how effective their lecture was or the instruction that they gave previously was. And so reporting is a big deal in our application of these technologies, reporting to the instructor, saying your students don't get concept number 128B, right? And so go back and reteach 128B or recognize that maybe that's at the wrong level for this cohort.
I also think, and this is something at CZI that we're thinking quite a lot about, this is where this notion of inclusive design comes in very heavily, where, you know, it's really imperfect to have sat in our boardrooms, come up with what we think AI for this classroom should be, and then, you know, go out with it and see how it works. We probably need to reverse it, to do it more in that, kind of D-school style design, where we actually sit with the users from the beginning, or from the point at which we're making revisions, but especially from the beginning, and then try to bring that all in. That also relates to issues of equity, too, that, you know, different schools have different affordances, different crazy schedules, different demands, and if we're not actually in there with them, this may not be so easy to actually figure out. So we're coming down on our last few minutes here, and I thought maybe starting from your end, Matt, and come this way, we might take just a minute and a half each to talk about what do each of us think is most important to make improvements in adaptive learning at scale in the next few years? What seems most important to change or to add to make this to make improvements in adaptive learning at scale? Matt, why don't you start us off, and we'll just come down the line.
Yeah, I think that there is dramatic improvement to be made in our ability to subtly evaluate those knowledge gaps and how students put together the knowledge that they need to complete an exercise, to complete to make use of the learning. And we're getting better on the granularity every year. Every year we kind of adjust the level of granularity, which currently creates an added workload in terms of building content to solve the granularity problem. So, you know, there are all sorts of kind of less sexy elements of the project that need to happen as well. We need to be able to develop assessments less expensively, for example, so that we can use more of them. And they need to be more subtle in their engagement. I think understanding the full context is also an important area. And starting to bring in some of those social elements into our environments.
I think one of the biggest bottlenecks in adaptive learning being applied scalably has been that there is a lack of good, efficacious, and meaningful metadata on the content itself. Adaptive learning on the surface seems very straightforward. You know, if you know this is the content, assessment content to be delivered, and this is what each item is going to give me evidence about as far as skill gaps are concerned, here's the learning content, which is specifically about this particular learning objective, you just deliver that. Very straightforward. The problem is, we don't know how to actually tag content in a scalable, meaningful fashion that captures the whole, you know, gamut of these learning objectives, skills, standards, and so forth. So if you're able to solve that problem from both the assessment side and the learning side, then I think we would have made a huge advance, because the rest of the machinery, as you pointed out, Matt, is built out. We have the knowledge graphs, which know the relationships between concepts. We understand the progression of learning and so on and so forth. But as the saying goes, garbage in, garbage out.
Ulrik.
So I'm not a huge believer in knowledge graphs, as some of you might know. I think we need to solve it in another way. And I think that's probably one of the fundamental fights we have in the industry, whether you really will ever be able to solve this problem that way, or whether you have to fundamentally rethink this to harbor and embrace the vast differences in how people learn. We've consistently shown that a factor of an order of magnitude, 10x difference between the slowest learners and the fastest learners who eventually gets to full comprehension and proficiency, is very, very normal to find. Think about how rarely our educational systems are equipped to handle that. So I'm excited about, what I also think is a really big challenge, is how do we help catalyze this change where we can convince the educational world that we probably need to radically rethink how we establish this. And I think that, like, I'm not as worried actually about the metadata, because after having done like giant retagging and recuration projects over the last years, where, I don't know, we've probably tagged 200 million learning objectives or something crazy. So I actually think that if you get granular enough, you get quite close. But I think it's at a bigger scale, and how do you then get the impact of, if you can deliver this and handle that variance of how people learn? And I think fundamentally, one of the things that go wrong is when we deploy these systems, we often have to sell them into fixing the problem of yesterday. But our real aspiration is to fix the problem of tomorrow, which is we probably need to learn things at a much deeper level than we did yesterday if we are to compete with robots and algorithms in the lives of as humans. And that means that we are trying to a little bit run around the teachers, trying to solve the problem that they should be really be solving, but right now their daily lives forces them to focus on what the world they're in right now. And I think that there's not an obvious answer to how to do it. I think that it's the usual way that you have to move fast but gently.
Go ahead.
So, you know, at its core, AI, machine learning, it's identifying patterns in huge sets of data and doing something with those patterns. And for truly adaptive learning to be here at last, it has to be here for everyone. And that's simply not the case today. And so I think the real breakthrough that technology will do in the next 20 years is to identify patterns of systemic bias, of unfair practices and admissions. If you can identify those patterns, you can fix them, or at least, at minimum, mitigate against them. And I think if and when that occurs, that's going to really have a sea change level effect on the education system.
So as I think about this, I think and it's come up already, there's something really powerful about having expert teachers and the support tools deeply interacting over customizing what is happening to the learners. And I think an important place that is still undercooked is the assessment side of this, the actual evidence collection. And not just are you getting the right answers, but also process evidence. Have you begun down a good path of designing an essay or of solving a problem or picking out data to populate with? And I do think, I mean, there has been some work, primitive as it is, on things like, can you measure affect off of click streams? And, you know, there are some folks who are doing that kind of work. But to me, it should not be a one-way flow. I feel like, wouldn't it be cool if your teachers as well could be saying back to the technology something about, you know, Bror is looking like he's bored. He's not engaged in this, right? So that the technology doesn't have to do that. It's rather the teacher is looking for additional ideas for how to engage little Bror, given that I can tell this ain't working for him. And so that there's more of a partnership in the data sharing and in the collaborative work, so that it really is a system, a system of work with feedback that is very adaptive to the teachers as well. And the other thing I'd say, and we didn't talk about this much, is I think there's something powerful about adaptive learning for teachers themselves. I mean, they don't all walk in like clones, being tabula rasas with nothing in their brains, just needing to be downloaded too. You actually, if you were going to do this properly, you would need parallel, adaptive, scalable, effective learning environments for your teacher preparation programs and for your in-class learners. Think how fast the learning environments for teachers are changing. You need really effective and adaptive systems for the teachers themselves. Unless anyone else has another minute worth, I'm tempted to give our audience 3 minutes of their life back. Is that reasonable? All right, enjoy your 2 minutes and 45 seconds.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much.